Bader Ginsburg, who was far more than merely a Supreme Court justice, has died. She was only the second woman ever appointed to the court and was already a legend when she arrived in the fight for gender equality. Sandra Day O'Connor was the first. Justice Ginsburg was the second. Justice Ginsburg died at home in Washington, surrounded by family, we're told, from complications of pancreatic cancer. She was 87 years old, and despite her long bout with several different forms of cancer and all the complications, she seemed to many indestructible. Just last night, she appeared remotely at the National Constitution Center, where she was honored with the center's Liberty Medal. In the coming hours, we'll be talking to the people who knew her best. We'll look at her remarkable legacy, both before she got to the Supreme Court and after, and whether the president will try to fill her position with the election fast approaching. Joining us right now by phone, CNN Chief Political Analyst Gloria Borger, on the phone as well as CNN Chief Legal Analyst Jeffrey Toobin, who's written extensively on the Supreme Court. Also on the phone, CNN's Ariane DeVogue and Dr. Sanjay Gupta. Jeff Toobin, let's start with you. First of all, just I know you were speaking to Aaron earlier, but for our viewers who are just joining us, just talk about Justice Ginsburg. Jeff Toobin, can you hear me? Okay, we don't have Toobin. Let's check in with Sanjay Gupta just to talk about the medical aspect on this. Sanjay, pancreatic cancer is obviously an extremely difficult form. She has been through so much. You know, there were so many people pulling for her, hoping she would go on for years.
Yeah, I mean, she's really dealt with a lot, Anderson. I mean, you know, you go back to 1999, 20 years ago. She 21 years ago, she was dealing with colon cancer at that time. She was first diagnosed with pancreatic cancer back in 2009, so 11 years ago. And, you know, at that time, I think the thinking was that maybe she had been able to really get through that, and she was sort of disease-free. In fact, you may remember in January of this year, Anderson, she sort of made an announcement that she was cancer-free. 2 years ago before this, she had another type of cancer as well, lung cancer, so it was colon, pancreatic cancer, and then lung cancer. But I think it was in May of this year, Anderson, you may remember, when she had this recurrence, this question of a recurrence, and then again in July. And at that point, she made it clear that she did have this recurrence. She had tried medications like immunotherapy and really did not have a response to it. So at that point, she had a procedure basically to open up some of the ducts that sometimes become affected by this sort of cancer, and was put on a therapy that, you know, doctors sort of said was not curative. This was not going to be a cancer that was going to be cured at that point. But she, you know, is amazing, Anderson. You remember she got through that therapy. She got out of the hospital. She was out and about again. She said that she would resume her duties. It's a tough therapy that she went through. It's a lot to go through for anybody. Obviously, someone who's in their mid to late 80s, even harder. But she seemed to be doing okay. But I think at that point, Anderson, I think going back to July now, it was pretty clear that this cancer was not going to be something that was going to be effectively treated. I just didn't know how quickly it would spread.
Hmm. Douglas Brinkley is also joining us. Doug, your thoughts on her passing?
Well, it's an incredible loss to America. And I think of her, and when I teach her about her legacy at universities, about being this women's activist. I mean, she was an extraordinary fighter for women's rights. And, you know, Anderson, when Bill Clinton selected her, nobody thought, you know, she would be picked in 1993. You know, they were looking with when Byron White was going to be retiring, and the thought was it would be Breyer. Nobody thought about Ginsburg, but Hillary Clinton knew all about Ruth Bader Ginsburg. She was so influenced by her, Hillary Clinton, and she told her husband, President Bill Clinton, really look at her. She is something extraordinary. And there's a funny story, because Bill Clinton didn't want the press seeing it, but so they told Ginsburg to come in on a Sunday evening to the White House, but be kind of incognito, wear just, you know, regular clothes. I thought it was going to be informal, and there was Bill Clinton watching a football game, all dressed in a suit and tie, and she was like in lounge clothes, and she was deeply embarrassed. But it took Bill Clinton about 10 minutes to realize that Hillary Clinton was right, that this was the winner. And he went to bat for her. And we have to remember, when Bill Clinton picked Ruth Bader Ginsburg, There had been Republicans in the White House for the 12 prior years, so this was a big thing. And every year, really, month by month, she is, as Supreme Court Justice, just grew into the legend we know. And President Clinton told me not that long ago, over the summer, that when he had her once come to the Clinton Library in Arkansas, she had so many people waiting, like 15,000 fans in Arkansas, that they had to move her from the presidential library to get a sports arena because of her popularity was so great. So when we look at some of Bill Clinton's great moves as president, picking her surely was one of them.
Yeah. Tonight, there's a lot to focus on. There's both the life that she lived, her legacy, and also, obviously, the political ramifications, the judicial ramifications of this moving forward just in the next several weeks and months. Hillary Clinton just tweeted, quote, "Justice Ginsburg paved the way for so many women, including me. There will never be another like her. Thank you, RBG." Dana Bash is standing by as well. Dana, just talk about there's a lot of people tuning in right now wondering what this means for the Supreme Court, what this means for Capitol Hill and a confirmation process and the election.
If you think that we have seen bitter partisanship, a very divided, frankly, angry Congress, you ain't seen nothing yet. And that is because this is sort of the crown jewel when it comes to what a president can do and what a Congress can do that lasts a lifetime. And that is to fill a Supreme Court vacancy, especially a vacancy as important when it comes to the balance of the bench as Ruth Bader Ginsburg's. The fact that, as Manu was talking about earlier, that it was 4 years ago that Republicans who were also in charge of the Senate refused to allow even a hearing for then President Obama's nominee, Merrick Garland, because Mitch McConnell said that the American people deserve a voice. You would think that there would be some consistency and that same majority leader, Mitch McConnell, would say, okay, we're so close to an election, the American people deserve a voice. But that's not how it is going to work, likely. How it is most likely going to work is that the Republican leadership, they are going to try to do something in the short term, if not in what is known as the lame duck session. So after the election, they're going to try to push this through. And Anderson, when I say this, a presidential nominee to replace her. And the rules right now, not to get too into the nitty gritty, but this matters a lot, is they just need a simple majority. And Republicans right now have that. There's going to be a lot of fighting. And I will just tell you real quick that it was not an accident that the Democratic Senate leader, Chuck Schumer, released or sent out a tweet saying something along the lines of the American people should have a voice in selecting their next Supreme Court justice. He clearly intentionally took the verbatim verbiage from Mitch McConnell 4 years ago to try to throw it back in his face. This is going to be a huge, huge brawl.
Well, Dana, just lay out, because Manu Raju earlier was saying it's unlikely that the Republicans would be able to get a nominee passed mm-hmm. by Election Day, but mm-hmm. there's a session, a lame duck session after Election
exactly.
Day.
Exactly. That's exactly right. They could start the ball rolling, and you better believe that particularly Mitch McConnell, despite the accusations that are already flying about just blatant hypocrisy, Mitch McConnell in particular, the Republican leader of the Senate, now the majority leader, he has been singularly focused on filling the bench, the federal bench at every level with conservative judges. It has been remarkable because so much news has been going on. We haven't maybe been able to pay attention as much as we could have, but it is remarkable how many Trump appointees are now on the bench. And when it comes to the Supreme Court, that is the ultimate. And it is a number one goal and has been his whole career for Mitch McConnell. So he's probably going to be impervious to accusations of hypocrisy. But I'm already getting texts from Democrats saying that they want to try to figure out a way around it to try to block McConnell from doing that in any time, either now or more likely, as Manu was saying, in a lame duck session after the election.